yesterday, which was the discussion of what happens if we try to solve the equation of motion of a real scalar field coupled to an external source, J of x. And we argue that we can parameterize the general solution phi of x as two terms. The first is the solution to the free equation without the source, phi naught of x, and then the term we call the Green function, there is an integral in d4y, g of x minus y, j of y, where this g of x minus y, because of the equation of motion, must satisfy the equation box plus m squared, g of x equal to minus I delta 4 of x. And just for completeness, phi naught, which was the solution to the free equation, has the general form d3p over 2 pi q, 1 over 2 omega p, some coefficient a tilde p, e to minus I px, plus a tilde star p, e to the I px, where p naught here is forced to be omega p by the equation of motion. So from now on, in the expression px inside the integral d3p solution of the free equation, I will always implicitly assume that the zero component of the momentum p is fixed to omega p by the equation of motion. Okay, so this was just a brief summary of where we left yesterday. And so the general solution, in order to write down explicitly the general solution, all we have to do is to solve this equation. Now, first, before solving it, let me comment on one point. You see, this equation here is not much different from this. It's just a particular case where the source is proportional to the delta function. But as this equation was not determining phi of x uniquely, because you can always shift the solution by the free equation, also this solution does not fix the Green function uniquely. If you solve this equation, you can always shift g of x by something proportional to phi naught, and it will still be a solution to this equation, because also in this case you will have a term proportional to the solution of the homogeneous equation. So this g of x, just from this equation, is not unique. And there are several different choices of Green function you can choose. The difference between one Green function and another one will be just a shift in phi naught here. So at the end, when you will impose initial condition, all the ambiguities will go away. But until you don't impose what are your initial conditions in the problem, there will be an ambiguity also in the choice of the Green function, which can be reabsorbed in this coefficient, say a tilde and a star. Okay? Alright, so how we solve this equation? Well, in a similar way as we did for the free case, we just Fourier transform. So we introduce the Fourier transforms of the Green function, g of x. We can rewrite it as the integral in d4p over 2 pi q to the 4, g tilde p, which is the Fourier transform of g, e to the I minus I px. And then we also write the four-dimensional delta function, delta 4, in terms of Fourier modes, which means that you can write the d4 x as the integral in d4 t over 2 pi to the 4 times e to the minus I t x. The Fourier transform of the delta is just the identity. So all we have to do now is to replace this expression in here. And as before, this box plus m squared acting on g, box act on x, which only appears in the exponent. It brings down a minus ip all squared, which is minus p squared. So this equation here just maps into, so the integral in d4t over 2 pi to the 4, which I put it outside. Then we have a box plus m squared on this, which gives me minus p squared plus m squared g tilde p, the exponent. For the moment, I'm not writing it. And then I have equal minus I, with some abuse of writing, I write the equation like this, okay? So basically I have this equal to the same integral with just the minus I here, and since this expression is identically equal in Fourier modes, it must be, the two terms must match for each choice of p. So this means that I can invert this equation and find that g tilde p must satisfy the equation I over p squared minus m squared for generic p. And if this is the case, then this equation is satisfied. So I can write the solution for the Green function formally as the integral in d4p over 2 pi to the 4 I over p squared minus m squared e to the minus I p x. So it's pretty simple to check, right? You have with box plus m squared here, you box plus m squared acting on here brings down a minus p squared plus m squared, which simplifies the denominator, leaving a minus I times what is left is a delta function, which is exactly the right hand side of the equation. So we have an integral form for the Green function, similar to what we had for the solution of the free equation. I a little bit cheated somewhere here, when, in particular when I inverted this expression here. In fact, this equation is equal to minus I if and only if p squared is different from m squared. If p squared is equal to m squared, then the left-hand side will be zero, and this equation will not be satisfied. Unless, of course, g tilde is singular. Indeed, you see from here that when p squared is equal to m squared, g tilde explodes. So this integral here is not well-defined, as is written here, because there is a pole, you see? For example, when you integrate over p naught, if I write the integral of p naught explicitly, this denominator is just p naught squared minus p squared minus m squared, which is omega p squared. So when p naught is equal to plus or minus omega p, the integrand is singular and the integral is ill-defined. So what we do about it? So one way to define this integral properly is the following. And okay, let me, I can keep the graph here. Is to consider the analytic continuation of this integral into the complex p-naught plane. So this plane here is the analytic continuation of p-naught. So this is a real p-naught, and this is imaginary p-naught. And the original integral was an integral over all p-naught from minus infinity to plus infinity in the real axis. So it was an integral along the real axis on this plane. But this integral, unfortunately, has poles. In particular, there are two poles, one at p naught equal omega p, and one at p naught equal to minus omega p. So there is a pole here, and a pole here at omega p and minus omega p. So one way to define this integral is to deform the path of integration away from the poles and define the integral as a limit when the path of integration goes on the real axis. So for example, we might define a path of integration just like this. In this case, the integral will be well defined. And then we make the limit of this path that go on the real axis. And for any point, for any size of this deformation, as long as the deformation is non-zero, the integral is well defined and the limit is well defined. However, this deformation is not unique because you might have defined a different deformation. For example, a deformation that avoids the poles from below. Or you can define deformation go above one and below the other, and so on. So the difference between one deformation and the other deformation are just integrals close integrals along each pole. And as you know, by Cauchy theorem, an integral on a complex plane which encircles a pole, it just returns the residue of on that pole of the function, weighted with some 2 pi r. So there is an ambiguity in the definition of this integral. The ambiguity is just related to the residue of these poles, which means that the ambiguity is just the evaluation of the integral in p-naught on the pole, which means, but the pole you see is really p-naught equal to omega p or minus omega p. And what is left is the residue, which is 1 over, as we'll see, is 1 over 2 omega p times this. So, but then you see, you recover what is left will be the integral in d3p, 1 over 2 omega p times the exponent, computed at a p naught equal omega p. But this is nothing else than one of these terms here, with the a tilde equal to 1 or a tilde equal to 1, which is the solution to the free equation. So, the ambiguity in defining the Green function from fixing different paths on this plane, the difference corresponds indeed, the ambiguity corresponds indeed to a different addition of the homogeneous equation of this equation. So there is a one-to-one correspondence between the choice of paths on this plane here and the contribution from the homogeneous part of this equation. So the bottom line is that you can choose whatever path you want to define your Green function, because whatever choice you make, the ambiguities will be reabsorbed when you fix eventually the coefficients, the integration constant of the free equation, phi naught. So you just fix your convention for the Green function, and the ambiguity will be taken care of by the freedom you have in this coefficient in the homogeneous part of the solution. Is it the logic clear and the mathematical steps? Let me know if you have any question, if there's anything not clear. Okay? All right, so then if this part is clear, I'll go through some more explicit examples of different choices of these contour integrals, which lead to different Green functions. And if you want, the difference between the Green functions, we said, is just a different choice of phi naught, which means it's like a different choice of initial conditions to this equation here. And the different choices I will make will be more useful or more convenient depending on the problem we want to solve. So I'll give you just a few examples that are relevant for different problems, and then you'll see that in particular one or two will play an important role in the rest of the course. If you allow me, I will erase part of the blackboard. Okay, then erase this. And so the first case I will discuss is what is called retarded Green function. And this corresponds basically to the case where you define your Green function by taking a path that is deformed above each of the two singularities. So this is g of x is this integral with a prescription that the imaginary part of p naught is always positive, so that it means that you deform the path above. So, what is the peculiarity of this choice and why it's called retarded Green function? What we're going to do is to perform this integral in P naught explicitly and see what we get. So, we can divide the problem in two cases. First, let me discuss what happened when the time inside x, if you want x naught, is negative. So if x naught is negative here, you see this exponent here is of the form minus I p naught x naught plus I px. So if x naught has a negative, if x naught is negative, then for I can do the following. I can consider this path here, and I can attach an arc that does this, and consider the integral over this path here, and then from here I come back, and then send this arc to infinity. Okay? So, why I'm considering this? So, for two reasons. First of all, the integral along this path, which means the original one, plus this arc, the sum of these integrals give me zero, because by Cauchy theorem, there are no singular, no poles inside this contour, closed contour, so the integral is automatically zero. Besides, the integral itself over this arc, if I send the arc to infinity, it gives me zero, because on this arc, the imaginary part of P naught is positive. So if P naught has a positive imaginary part, you see there is a minus I, there is the I of the imaginary part here, which gives me plus, but x naught is negative, so it's minus. So this is a negative exponent. And if the modulus of P naught goes to infinity, because I'm sending the arc to infinity, this exponent is exponentially suppressed. In particular, the integrand goes to zero exponentially fast. So when the arc goes to infinity, this object is zero, so the integral over this arc is zero. So you see, I have that the integral over the whole path is zero, the integral over only the arc is zero. This implies that the original integral along the original contour is also zero. Which means that for x naught negative, g, let me call it retarded, define it that way, is identically zero. Any questions about this argument? Followed? If it's not clear, I'll explain it again. Okay?
Excuse me, can you explain again why, when we send the above part to infinity, the integral vanishes?
Yes. So we are performing a linear integral over this arc, right? So what is this arc? This arc is in the complex P naught plane, is P naught will be some modulus of P naught times some phase, and the phase go from 0 to pi. Okay? So in particular, this is modulus of P naught cos phi plus I sine phi. The arc to infinity means that the modulus of P naught is going to infinity. So the imaginary part, so and for phi between 0 and pi, the sine is positive. So you have that imaginary part is going to infinity, and it's positive. So this P naught in this limit will go to infinity I infinity. X naught is negative, so you have minus I times I, which is 1. X naught negative is minus infinity. This object here is going to minus infinity. So you have an integral of something that is e to the minus infinity, which is 0. So it's identically 0. Okay? Any other questions? Okay. So then we need to know what happens when x naught is positive. So if x naught is positive, I cannot perform the same trick. Because if x naught is positive, now this will go to e to the plus infinity. So the integral over this arc will explode. So I don't know what I will get. But then I can do another thing. I can close the contour with an arc that goes below. Because now the fact that x naught is positive is compensated by the fact that the imaginary part of P naught is negative below. So again, the integral over the arc is 0, which means that my original integral here is equal to the integral over this closed contour. Because I'm just adding 0, which is the integral over the arc. But now I can use Cauchy theorem. Now I get something on 0, because inside this contour integral I have two poles. So I get something from them. So what Cauchy theorem tells you? It tells you that the result of the integral will be, so I have an integral in B3P, which I'm not performing yet, over 2 pi cubed. Then I have a contribution which is 2 pi I times the residues of each of these poles. So 2 pi, I'm using to simplify one of the 2 pi's here. So I only wrote 2 pi cube. I get an I which multiply this I and give me minus 1. But the minus 1 is simplified also by the fact that here I'm considering the path that which goes clockwise. Instead, Cauchy theorem that give you a contribution which is 2 pi I when you take the contour anti-clockwise. So there is an extra minus from there, which is compensated with the minus from I squared. So all I get is just the sum of the residue themselves and the final factors. So this pole here is at P naught equal to minus omega P. So this integral here, this denominator here is nothing else but P naught plus omega P times P naught minus omega P. So this guy here is this pole. So the residue is this object 1 over this object here, computed P naught equal to minus omega p. So I get minus 2 omega p. And minus 2 omega p. So I get 1 over 2 omega p with a minus. Times this object here, computed at p naught equal to minus omega p, which is e to the I omega p x naught plus I px. So this is the contribution from this residue. And then I have the contribution from this other residue, which is this pole here. So the residue is just 1 over this, computed P naught equal omega P, so it's 1 over 2 omega P. This time with a plus. And the exponent is computed P naught equal to plus omega P, so it's e to the minus I omega P x naught plus I P x. Hope I didn't make mistakes. And okay. Now, in the first part, like we did for the free scalar field, I can change variable and send p in minus p. I'm integrating over all d3p, so I can integrate over all d minus d3p, right? So I can just flip the sign here. Omega p is an even function of three momentum, so this doesn't change, and the integral, of course, it doesn't change. So I can rewrite it in this way. And, well, this is going to be the final expression, except that, of course, this only when x naught is positive. So let me introduce one object, which I'm going to write here. Let me introduce, so I don't need to rewrite everything many times, the function delta plus minus of x, defined as the integral in d3p over 2 pi q, 1 over 2 omega p, e to the minus I px, with the p naught equal to omega p. And here there is a minus or a plus. So if you take a plus, it's a minus. If you take a minus, it's a plus. So this is just the definition of this delta function here. And notice that delta plus of x is also equal to delta minus of x complex conjugate, because you just flip the sign of the I here. And it's also equal to delta minus of minus x, because if you flip the sign of x, of course, you get the other function. So this is just a definition. And with this definition, the final expression for the retarded Green function can also be written as, so theta of x naught, which imposes that the retarded Green function is zero if x naught is negative, and for x naught positive, must be equal to this expression here, that written in those, in terms of those function, is just delta plus of x minus delta minus. So you see, this delta plus and delta minus function here are, if you want, connected to the solution of the free equation. If you remember, the solution to the free equation was a combination of this delta plus and delta minus with arbitrary coefficients in front here. These are particular, if you want, solutions with a particular coefficient. So what makes the Green function is actually this term here. In fact, if you apply box plus m square here, when it applies to the deltas, you get zero. But you get a non-zero contribution when the time derivative acts here and here. When the time derivative acts here, the derivative of a step function is a delta in time. And from here you get a delta. With one derivative you get a delta in space. And you re-recover the equation for the Green function, which is I delta 4. So this is the Green function. So it's called retarded now. The meaning is now should be more clear, because if you write the support of this function in space and time, let's say that this is space and this is time, or x naught, as I called it. The Green function, what is it? Is the response of the field, right, to a source that is localized in the origin, a delta function in the origin. And this response, it's zero at all time, which are negative, which are means before the source. So this Green function is zero at negative time. And it's only non-zero after you turn on the source, as you would expect. So in this sense, it's called retarded, because it has only support after you turn on the source. There is more. So if you look at the Green function from this expression here, in this expression, you see that the Green function is written in a way which is covariant. In particular, you see it's an integral in d4p. Here it only depends on p through an invariant, which is p squared. And here you have a scalar product of p and x. So this means that the g as a function of the four vector x must be such that it only depends on invariant combination of x, which means can only depend on the combination x squared. So you can check that if you perform a Lorentz transformation, gx will go in g lambda minus 1 of x. But if you put lambda minus 1 of x here, and you redefine p by lambda minus 1 p, you get exactly the same answer. So g of x is an invariant. So it must be only dependent on invariant combination of x, which is x squared. But this means the following. It means that if the function is zero here, let's say outside the past Lightcon, and you perform a Lorentz boost, you can map the function from any point here through an hyperbola to any point here. So the function must only depend on x squared, so if it's zero here, must be zero everywhere here. Similar for here. So this means automatically that the function is also zero here, and it must be zero here. So this Green function is zero everywhere outside the Lightcon, and is only non-zero inside the future Lightcon. As you would expect. So this is really a physical Green function, in the sense that if you have a source localized somewhere, the field will respond to this source by exciting itself only in points which are causally connected to the source. Only points which are in the future light cone of the source will get a non-zero field. The rest will stay where had a zero field before and will stay zero also after. So this choice of paths is pretty convenient to solve problems where you have some initial boundary conditions, some source which is localized in space and time somewhere, or some with some compact support. So if you have now a generic source J of X which is localized somewhere, and say the field is zero before, you'll get that each point of the source will act as a delta function, which will sort the field in their future lifetime. And the final answer for the field will be the convolution of all this contribution over the support of the source. So you get the field is non-zero only in the future light cone of the whole source, while everywhere else the field will stay zero. If the field before was not zero, it means that you will have also the final psi of x will also have some contribution from phi naught. The final answer will just be the sum of these two. This is the contribution which is directly sourced by the source itself, plus the contribution of the field which was already there before, and which is completely fixed by the boundary condition you impose, for example, at the beginning. So, away from the light cone, the field will propagate freely, depending on its initial condition, and inside the future light cone of the source, you will get an extra contribution, which is the part of the field which is actually sourced by the source itself. So in this way, you can now solve any problems of this kind, where you have some initial condition plus some extra contribution coming from an explicit source. And this is actually also what happens, for example, in a Maxwell equation. It's just slightly more complicated by the fact that the field is a vector instead of a scalar, but it's otherwise completely analog to this. You can write this generic solution as contribution of free waves plus a retarded Green function coupled to an explicit electromagnetic source. Any questions?
I have a question.
Yes.
So if you had choose the contour integral in the other way, to down, so it will be like the past version of this?
Yes.
Is that true?
Yes.
And what about if you choose like one up and one down? Like yeah. What does that correspond to?
I'm going to answer very soon because I'm going to discuss all these cases. Any question about this specific case before I show you the other ones? So the other cases are now simpler since it's already one. So for example, as you guys guys mentioned, I could consider a case where I chose to deform the contour on the negative imaginary plane, and what will I get? We'll get a different Green function. If that was the retarded Green function, you might not be surprised that this is called the advanced Green function. And basically what happens is the exact opposite of what was happening with the previous one. If I now have positive times, positive x naught, I can close the contour below, because with positive x naught, like before, I need to choose negative imaginary part for p naught, so that I get minus infinity here, I get zero on the arc. But then, in this contour encloses no poles, and Cauchy theorem tells me that the full integral is zero, the integral on the arc is zero, it means that the integral on the original path is zero. So this function now vanishes in the future. While for the past, which means x naught negative, like before, I can just attach an arc that closes at positive imaginary part of p naught. But unlike before, now I get a non-zero result because I enclose the two poles. So you might not be surprised that you can repeat exactly the same steps as we did before, and what you'll get is that the final contribution will be non-zero only at negative x naught, so there will be a theta of x naught. There are two contributions from the two poles. And there's just a factor of extra minus here, because now the contribution of the two pole comes by enclosing a contour which is anticlockwise. So there is a plus sign 2 pi I, and I squared give you minus. So there is an extra minus compared to before, because the contour that give you a zero contribution, it's going anticlockwise instead of clockwise. So there is a minus here. And the rest are the two residues, the contribution coming from the two residues of the pole. So this is what is called the advanced Green function, and it has support exactly opposite to the retarded one. So it will correspond to a function which is non-zero only in the past leg. So it's zero everywhere in the future, by Lorentz invariance must be zero also in the past, outside the past light cone, and is non-zero only in the past light cone. So, of course, the physical interpretation of this problem now is completely opposite to the previous one. If you want, is the exactly a time reversal process, where you have you start with some field configuration here that collapses to a point, and then it disappears completely in the future. So if you want, the source now, it acts like a perfect sink, where the field basically go and finish there and disappear. So these are two different Green functions, as you see. They're, if you want, they're complementary. And you can check indeed that the difference between the two Green functions is indeed a solution to a to the homogeneous equation. So you can consider, for example, the g retarded x minus g advanced x, the difference between the two Green functions. Let me call it delta c. And of course, this object here, basically by construction, is the its solution of the free equation. Because you see, box plus m squared applied to gr give you minus I delta, the same when you apply to ga, and the difference, the delta, disappears and you get zero. So the difference between retarded and advanced Green function is indeed the solution to the equation of motion, the free equation of motion. And in fact, this delta c, now if you do the difference between gr and ga, is given by, so this part and this part are the same, so you get step function minus the step function minus x naught. This means that this is 1 when x naught is positive, and it's minus 1 when x naught is negative, so it's just the sine function. X naught, I have gr minus ga, so I have theta of x naught minus minus theta of minus x naught, so I have the sum of theta plus theta minus x naught. So I have a step function for x naught plus the step function for minus x naught, so I get unity. So this is just delta plus of x minus delta minus x. Okay? And now if you take delta plus minus delta minus, it's just this integral minus, so it's e to the minus ipx minus e to the ipx. So it's really the solution to the free equation when you choose a tilde p equal to I, I think. And this function has the property that is exactly zero outside the future and past, it's exactly zero outside the light cons, past and future, and it's non-zero in the future and past light cons. So it describes basically some free waves that come from minus infinity. They collapse on the origin, and then they fly away to plus infinity. It's a very particular solution for the equation of motion with some special initial condition. Or if you want, it's a solution to the initial condition. It's the solution to the free equation with the initial condition that at T0, the field is exactly localized on the origin. In fact, now you see that the difference between the integral of g retarded minus g advanced is the difference between this path and the path that go down. So the difference is just this path here that go in a circle here, and this path here that go in a circle here. And in fact, this and minus this are exactly this delta plus and delta minus. Delta plus is the integral here, and delta minus, if you minus delta minus, is the integral right here. So the integral localized on these poles are just the solution to the free equation. The green function instead corresponds to the integral go from one side to the other. Any questions? This object here, delta C, you see that will play a very important role when we quantize the theory. For now, it's just a particular solution of the equation of motion, but it is a special one. Okay. Then next, to finish, I'm going to just introduce the case more exotic, where I choose to avoid the singularities in a mixed way. Means I pass below the negative pole and above the positive pole. So this choice also has a name. It's called Feynman Green function or time order. And none of the two names will be clear today, will become clear when we'll do the quantum version. Let me see. Okay, so well, the result for this choice is very simple. At positive time, you remember positive time, you have to close the contour below. And this means that at positive time you only get a contribution from the positive pole residue. So the green function for positive time, so theta x naught, will only get a contribution from delta plus, which is the contribution from the residue at omega p. With a plus, because you close the contour clockwise, and then for negative times, you have to close it upstairs, so you select the residue at minus omega p, so at negative time, minus x naught, you get the contribution from delta minus. There is a plus exactly like here, we get a plus. So the result, the explicit result for the Feynman-Green function will be this combination delta plus and delta minuses. In this case, first of all, the Green function is general complex, as we will see, and is non-zero everywhere. So again, the importance of this choice will become explicit only when we'll do the quantized version of the theory, because they will enter there. But I can give you a flavor of why it could be interesting also in classical theory when I will now go through the actual computation of the integral. So we always wrote this expression in terms of this delta plus and delta minuses, which are these integral form functions. Now I'll show you how to actually integrate these functions explicitly in terms of known functions. This will answer a related question, how it compute. You remember in the first lecture, the evolution of the wave function in quantum mechanics localized on a point, because the integral that enters there is a very close friend of this. Okay, so I will do it. So let's now try to compute explicitly. In particular, I will start trying to compute explicitly G Feynman, the Green function, and then I will show how to relate them to the others. So notice that this choice here can also be rewritten in a different way. S, so now I'll write it here. G Feynman of X can also be written as the limit of epsilon going to zero of the integral in d for p over 2 pi to the 4. I'm basically just rewriting something very close to that. I over p squared minus m squared plus I epsilon e to the minus I dx. So what did I do? All I did was, instead of deforming the contour, I deformed the integrand by adding an imaginary part to the denominator in such a way that the integral in P0 now on the real axis doesn't have any poles anymore. So I shifted the poles a little bit on the imaginary plane by this I epsilon, and then I'm taking the limit epsilon goes to zero, which means bring back the poles to the real axis. So what I did actually was to keep the integration contour on the real axis, and then I just moved the two poles by something proportional to epsilon away from the real axis. You can check that indeed the positive pole move a little bit on the negative imaginary plane, while the negative poles moves up a little bit on the imaginary positive plane, P0 plane. Just check that indeed the position of the poles here in the complex P0 plane are there. So you see that when I then make the limit epsilon goes to zero, the two poles hit the real axis and I recover the original integral with the right prescription of the formation of the contour. So, okay, so now I perform another trick. which is the following. I'm going to analytically continue x naught to, which is time, right, to imaginary values. In particular, I want to send x naught to x naught e to the minus I phi, and phi, which is this, maybe I shouldn't call it phi because I called it, let me call theta, and theta, I send theta from 0 to pi over 2. So I give basically a phase to the time, I make it complex, and when I move it theta from 0 to pi over 2, I'm basically, what I'm doing is just sending x naught from real to purely imaginary, minus I x naught. Notice that if I perform this, this corresponds to basically consider the theory instead in Minkowski space, in Euclidean space, because now, for example, the invariant distance, which was x naught dx naught square minus dx square, after this analytic continuation, is mapped into minus I square. Here it goes to minus, let me call minus I x naught x, maybe I should call it x4 Euclidean. So this is minus dx4 square minus dx square, but now this is a SO4 invariant metric. So it's like time becomes space-like, and I get a theory which is Euclidean. So for me this is just an analytic continuation. So you have this function gf of x defined on real time, and I analytically continue to complex times, and then if I do an analytic continuation and I stop at theta equal to pi over 2, just do 90 degrees rotation, I arrived to basically the theory which is analogous to a theory living on four space dimensions instead of three space and one time direction. So for example, you can show that the analogous function after this analytic continuation satisfy the Green the Green function equation of motion box plus m square with the box defined in Euclidean, where all the signature is basically this one. Why am I doing this? Because this simplifies now this integral. So as I perform this rotation is also, in jargon, is also called the Vick rotation. And is done often, as you'll see in field theory, to simplify some calculation. When you perform this big rotation, at the same time, I can perform a similar rotation, analytic continuation on P naught, and I send P naught into P naught e to the I theta. So this analytic continuation corresponds to take the original path of integration and rotate it by an amount which is theta. So if I rotate x naught and p naught at the same time, the product is always real. So in the exponent here, I will have minus I p naught x naught plus I px, and this term here is always real, p naught x naught, which means that this exponent here is always oscillatory for any theta. Instead, the integrand, the rest of the integrand here, at large p naught, it goes to zero, like 1 over p naught squared, integrated over p naught. The integral of p naught is convergent, and is convergent for any theta. So you see that I'm allowed to make this rotation. As I do this rotation, I encounter no singularities. The values of the field at of the integrand at infinity goes to zero fast, so the integral is not changed all the way until I get to theta equal to pi over 2, where the integral is defined over the imaginary p naught axis. So if you want the integral, the analytic continuation of the GF in terms of Euclidean coordinates corresponds to take the integral p naught over now Euclidean momenta. P naught will become p naught times I, which I'm calling p for Euclidean in analogy. So let me write again. Maybe I erase this part. It's too confusing. To summarize what I did here was now to consider the Greek function analytically continuous into Euclidean space as a function of x, 1, 2, 3, 4 Euclidean, which are related to the other one with that deformation. And this is the integral. And now I take this integral with p naught replaced by basically a p naught I perform this rotation. So you see, when I integrate over p naught, here I have the integral in d for p Euclidean. In doing so, p naught got an extra I, so I have an I from here, from the Jacobian of the transformation. Then I have an I from here. Here p squared, but remember p squared is p naught squared minus p squared, and so if I send p naught in I p naught, then here I get minus p4 squared minus p squared, so this is minus p Euclidean squared minus m squared, and here I'm left with e to the minus I p4 x4 Euclidean plus I px. Sorry, I might have a confusion in the sense that, sorry, I think what I meant here was to call this x naught, I will call it my ix for Euclidean, and p naught, I will call it ip for Euclidean. So that they are related by an I. Okay, so I times I becomes minus 1, which makes these pluses. The limit in epsilon, now I can make it right away, because when epsilon goes to 0, these poles go here, but the contour of integration now is very far, it's along the imaginary axis, so nothing will change if I work at epsilon equal to 0. It's not singular anymore. So I can take the limit immediately. And as usual, let me change flip the sign of the vector p into minus the vector of p, so that I send this to minus itself. Here it's even in p, the integral doesn't change, and this is nothing else than the four-dimensional scalar product in Euclidean space, PEX. So this is the version, the Euclidean version of the Green function. So what is this? It's basically the same, the solution to the Euclidean version of the Green function equation. Where you see box now is defined in Euclidean space, is defined as di square with all pluses metric. There's a minus here from this minus here. And you can check that indeed, if you apply with the box E to here, this will pull down a minus PE square, with a minus become plus. P squared plus m squared will simplify this, and you get the delta function, which is this. So this is just the Green function of the Euclidean problem. And if we solve this explicitly, then we can get back what we were looking for, which was the original Feynman Green function in real time, by just analytically continue back time to the original. So this choice of deformation of poles corresponds basically to the Green function that you will get if you start in Euclidean space and you analytically continue to real time. The Green function, the Euclidean Green function, this corresponds to this particular choice of deformation. So it's special in this sense because it's the prescription that naturally comes from the analytic continuation from Euclidean to Minkowski space of the Green function in Euclidean. Then all we have to do now, I didn't do much in just doing so. I just basically, the advantage now is that the poles are away, because now I'm integrating over the imaginary axis, which is the Euclidean momentum p, which is far from the poles. And this means that this integral now, the integrand is non-singular already in the path of integration. So I can take the integral directly. Okay? So the next question is how to integrate this in a smart way. This can be done by exploiting the fact that this integral is in a nice form which is symmetric under SO4 rotation. So I'll show you a trick, if you don't know it already. Before I erase anything, let me ask you if you have any questions about this logic and this procedure. So now let me then erase here and try to compute this. I should have, let me rewrite above the rest. Don't have enough blackboard. So I want to compute. The integral mv4pp over 2 pi to the 4, 1 over pe squared plus m squared e to the minus I pe x e. So let me write this in the following way. I write the integral as before. This denominator, let me write it as another integral, integral in the alpha between 0 and infinity of e to the minus alpha to the denominator. And then I have minus I e t x t. So you see the trick? The integral in the alpha or e to the minus alpha, the integral of an exponent is just you rescale alpha by this, so it becomes 1 over pe squared plus m squared, which is this term here, and then you are left with the integral of the exponent between 0 and infinity, which is 1. So I write in this way, because now, if I write in this way, the integral d4p, I can make it explicitly, because now p appears only in the exponent. And this is an exponent which I know, because it's like a Gaussian exponent, which I can perform directly. So let me write this as the integral in the alpha between 0 and infinity. Let me pull out e to minus alpha m squared, which does not depend on p. And then I'm left with an integral in d4pe over 2 pi to the 4 of e to the minus alpha pe squared minus I pe x e. Okay? Now, next step is, you see, this is almost a perfect square, so can add and remove constant here in pe. So that I can rewrite this as, let me write here, I can rewrite this as minus alpha pe plus I x e over 2 alpha squared. So you see that p squared is this term, the double product is I pe x e over 2 times 2 over alpha times alpha goes away and give me minus here, so it's exactly this term, and on top I have this squared. This square is a minus, with a minus is a plus, so I have to put minus x e squared over 4 alpha, so that it erases this square times minus alpha. So this guy here is the same as this. Now this is the integral over all pe, and in terms of pe, this is just a constant shift. But since I am integrating over all possible pe, I can just remove the shift. Can shift p by constant, this integral, even if it's complex, this integral will not change. And this term does not depend on p, and I can pull out. So I get integral in the alpha between 0 and infinity, e to the minus alpha m squared minus x e squared over 4 alpha, and then I'm left with e to the minus alpha pe squared integrated over this. I can also rescale pe by root alpha, so that this alpha disappears here, and because of the measure here, I get the 1 over alpha squared. And so then I'm just left to the integral in d, p, e, let's say prime, because I already rescaled it, over 2 pi to the 4, e to the minus p, e prime squared. Notice this is a, there are 4 integrals here, but this is, each integral is the same because e to the minus p e squared, this is a 4 vector square. So this is also each integral is a one integral to the 4, is the same. And this is the integral of a Gaussian, which gives you just some factor of 2 pi or square root of pi, which I never remember. I think is the result of this, you can check, should be 1 over 16 pi squared, which is to the 4th power. And so we'll be left with, let me write 1 over 16 pi squared, and then I have the integral in the alpha, this integral in the alpha. Let me make a change of variable, alpha equal to modulus of xe over 2n 1 over beta. So I rewrite alpha like 1 over beta and I rescale by this factor here. So the integral in the alpha now becomes an integral in the beta between 0 and infinity. The alpha over alpha squared is basically the beta. And this factor here will appear here explicitly, like a 2n over modulus of xc. This modulus of xc is just square root of xc squared. And you can see, now if you do this replacement, you can see that this exponent here becomes simply e to the minus n root modulus of xc over 2 beta plus 1 over beta. So basically I rewrote the whole integral, original one, which was 4 integrals of this ugly combination, just as a simple integral in one variable. So this 2 makes this an 8. So eventually I can rewrite this result as a 1 over 4 pi squared m over modulus of xc k1 of m xc, where k1 is the modified Bessel function, second kind, which has an integral representation, which is just 1 half the integral in the beta to 0 and infinity, e to the minus 1 half z beta plus 1 over beta, which is basically the integral I wrote there. So the original function then basically is related to the to one of the Bessel functions up to some constant, some explicit dependence in M and X in the front. So if you're not familiar with the Bessel function, just let me tell you what's the behavior of this function, in particular for positive for positive argument, notice that this is positive definite. So K1Z flows for large positive arguments. He has an exponential behavior which goes like e to the minus z, e to the minus the argument, times root pi over 2z. So at large, if you want a large distances, Euclidean distances, the Bessel function is exponentially small. This also tells you that at exponentially large Euclidean distances, the Green function is exponentially suppressed. So large distances is exponentially suppressed. So this is for z much larger than 1. Instead, for close to the origin, for z that goes to 0, which you can even think as the mass goes to 0, for small distances compared to the Compton wavelength of the mass here, the function goes like 1 over z, one of the above. So there is a pole of this function in the origin. Any questions on the steps? Okay, so this was the Euclidean function, Green function. So what about the original Feynman-Green function in real space, in real time? Well, all you have to do is just to convert back the time, Euclidean time, back to real time. So since x Euclidean 0 is equal to I x 0, x Euclidean square will be given by minus x naught square plus x square, which is minus what you call x Minkowski square. So, first of all, before writing explicitly the answer, notice the following. Every point in Euclidean space have xc squared equal positive, right? Because this is a scalar product with a positive metric, which means that this point in Euclidean space correspond to points which are outside the light curve, space-like in Minkowski. So every point in Euclidean space, which is the space where this function is defined, corresponds to the outside of the light cone in real space. The origin in Euclidean, which is just the point x equal to 0, corresponds to the light cone in Minkowski, while the inside of the light cone in real time, in Minkowski, doesn't correspond to anything in real Euclidean space because it corresponds to some imaginary analytic continuation of the Euclidean space. So these behaviors here are strictly for the outside of the light cone part of the real time of Minkowski space. In particular, this limit here, so I didn't write, was z much less than 1, z goes to 0, the pole here for z goes to 0 corresponds, z is just the measure in Euclidean space, would correspond to a pole on the life cone. So GF, basically now in real time, X, is that is basically this function here analytically continued to real time. So instead of modulus of XL, of X Euclidean, I should write minus square root of minus X squared, right? Because X Euclidean square is minus X squared, so the modulus is the square root of this. And similarly, for the argument of the Bessel function, which will become n, the mass, times the square root of minus x Euclidean square. Oh, sorry, x squared. So for space-like separation in x, this function matches the Euclidean one. In particular, this function is real. But then if you want to go to real, to time-like separations, x squared becomes positive, minus x squared is negative, and now this function here becomes complex. So you see that, first of all, the Green function is non-zero both inside and outside the light cone. And second, outside the light cone, the Green function is real. But inside, in general, is complex. We can take the similar limits here. So if we take the limit now that x squared minus x squared, so x squared is large and negative, so minus x squared, let's say m squared, is much larger than 1, so a large space-like separation. You can just replace this expression here, and you'll find that the Green function will be, well, some factor here will be exponentially suppressed in this separation. And instead, if you send the mass to zero, then you see that this Bessel function will go like 1 over the argument. The mass will simplify. Square root of minus x squared, square root of minus x squared will give you minus x squared, or x squared. And then you get that the GF of x, and this limit will go like one factor, 1 over 4 pi squared, 1 over x squared. If you analytically continue to positive x squared, so inside the light cone, you see that here this, the argument of square root will be negative. So this will be, in general, will be complex. It will be, actually, it will be purely imaginary. So instead of being exponentially suppressed, the Bessel function will be just oscillatory. It will be another Bessel function. So the picture is the following. Outside the light cone and very far, you get exponential suppression. On the light cone, you'll get a pole in x squared, so a singularity on the light cone. And inside the light cone, there are, you get something that is oscillatory. And here the Green function will be real, while here in general is complex. And in fact, these different behaviors of the Green function are connected with different problems in physics, like the fact that this Green function, a space-like separated point, is exponentially suppressed with e to the minus mx, will lead to the Yukawa potential that you can observe in some interaction mediated by massive fields. This 1 over x squared behavior for massless, in the massless limit, correspond, is related also to, it will lead to the 1 over r behavior in of the potential of massless interactions. And this oscillatory behavior inside the light cone is related to the fact that indeed waves are propagating inside the light cone. You might, I'm going a little bit over time, but just wanted to conclude this topic. I just need to add a few comments and I'm done. Do you have any questions so far? I'm sure you have. Few comments and then leave you. So this was basically the explicit expression in terms of Bessel function of the Green function, the Feynman Green function. And now you can use this to actually infer what is the answer for all the other Green functions. And to do that, if you go back and look at the formulas we wrote for the Green functions in terms of these delta functions, you can check and see that indeed, if you look at the real part of G Feynman, this is nothing else than 1 half delta plus plus delta minus. And the imaginary part is related to 1 over 2i, the sine of x naught times the difference, which was delta c. This just follows from the fact that delta plus star is equal to delta minus. And from the relation of GF with delta plus and delta minus and the step function. If you go and look and you consider the real part and the imaginary part, you'll find this expression very easily. And then, by inverting this relation here, in terms of delta plus and delta minus, you can also rewrite similar identities, which is delta plus is also equal to theta x naught g Feynman plus theta minus x naught g Feynman star. Delta minus is the complex conjugate of this. Delta c, you can invert this and find that this is related to 2i the sine of x naught, the imaginary part of g Feynman. And finally, g retarded and g advanced are just 2i theta x naught, the imaginary part of g Feynman, and g advanced 2i theta minus x naught, the imaginary part of G Feynman. So you see that delta C, which was, you remember, was the solution with the, which was zero inside the light cone, and the retarded and advanced spring function, which was only this part and this part, they are all related to the imaginary part of G Feynman. But you see that outside the light cone, this function is real. There is no imaginary part. And this explains now, in fact, why all these objects here are zero outside the light cone, because G Feynman is real outside the light cone. Outside the light cone. Inside the light cone, G Feynman is complex, because it comes from an analytic continuation. So in general, these objects are non-zero inside, except when the mass is zero. When the mass is zero, actually this square root and this square root simplifies. You get just 1 over x squared is zero. And this is real both inside and outside the light cone. This means that for massless fields, retarded Green function, advanced Green function, delta C, are zero, identically zero, not only outside the light cone, but also inside the light cone, if the mass is zero. They are only non-zero on the light cone, which indeed makes sense, because for massless particle, massless field, you will expect the field will propagate at the speed of light, so it will propagate on the light cone. Instead, for a massive field, you get a propagation inside the light cone because the speed is less than the speed of light. And this is more or less everything I wanted to say. So you see this, so far we used this Feynman-Green function just as a tool to compute explicitly the Green function form and for arguing about the properties of the other Green functions. But we will see later on that exactly this function here will play an important role when you compute observables in quantum field theories. Okay? Any question? Okay.